How's everybody doing this afternoon? I was expecting a little bit more of an audible response there, so let me try that one more time. How's everybody doing this afternoon? Outstanding. Well, it's wonderful to be here with you all at the APA 2023 convention. I'm particularly excited and grateful to be participating in a conference where the theme is You Belong Here. So in the spirit of that theme, I actually wanted to start out and have you all reflect on a question. Why are you here? Now, I know that sounds like an odd way to start a keynote. Some of you might actually be offended by that question. You might be thinking, why would he ask us that when we're here for his keynote presentation? But for any of you who took me seriously, maybe you started to think a little bit about why you're here at the APA convention this year. Maybe if I'd asked the question a little bit differently and centered in vocation, maybe some of you would have started to think about why you're in your psychology-related field or training program. Maybe if I had asked the question even differently, some of you might have leaned a little bit existential and started to think about why you're here on this earth or what your purpose is in life. Now, I did admit that question was a little bit open-ended, so I'm going to repackage it a little bit. I'm going to center on motivation and center on this moment. So now I would encourage you to reflect on why you're here at this conference, at this moment in time, at this session. Now, I imagine that some of you may be students, you may be researchers, you may be the clinicians and practitioners, and so maybe you're here because you're particularly interested in the topics that Dr. Silveri and I will be discussing. Maybe you're curious to hear more about some of the preclinical research or the translational research and how to integrate those two, or even how to tie those to aspects that relate to social justice and advocacy. Some of you might actually have expertise in those topics yourselves, and maybe you're here in true academic form because you're curious what we're going to talk about, and maybe you're planning to share some constructive criticism at the end of our talks as well. We would welcome that. It would be hard for me to imagine the next scenario, but it's also possible that some of you are here because you felt like you needed a filler. Now, with all of the great programming and content at this conference, that would surprise me, but it is a possibility. Also, I think at the same time, it would be fair for you all to ask me my motivation and why I'm here. But if I'm completely honest with you, the main reason that I'm here is because I'm frustrated. Now, I remember a few years ago, I had actually been invited to give a talk at Emory University. I was really looking forward to that talk because I had been invited by students on the campus to talk about mental health and faith. And so in that talk, they had paired me with a clinical psychologist on campus. We had some time to give opening remarks, and then we had a time of Q&A with the students. I remember one question in particular that really stood out to me. One of the students I later realized was a neuroscience student, but she was having a hard time helping one of her relatives navigate through anxiety and depression. And she said that her aunt kept being told that the only reason she wasn't getting better is because she wasn't praying hard enough. Frustration. Now, for me as a person of faith, I was encouraged to know that she was being encouraged to use spiritual practices. But as a neuroscientist, I was disheartened that she wasn't availing herself to all the tools that we have from things like social work, from psychology, from psychiatry, and from neuroscience. Now, fast forward a few years later, this time I was actually teaching a class to medical students at Yale, and I was team teaching with other professors. For my section, I was talking about the neurobiology of addiction and specifically focusing on brain processes that are important for reward, but are also invoked with craving and relapse. So we had a student who asked a question after the lecture and said, oh, this is all well and good, but what are we supposed to do with those people that think that belief in a higher power or spiritual practices can help them navigate through their addiction? Frustration, again. This time I have someone who's paying attention to biology, but being totally dismissive about all that we know about the power of faith practices, spiritual practices, and how those can help individuals navigate through, and how those things can be integrated with other behavioral practices as well. Now, some of you may know I actually host or I direct a research lab at the Yale School of Medicine. So that lab is made up of a lot of different individuals. We have undergraduate students, graduate students, postdocs, technicians, senior scientists, and we're all there researching and thinking about some common questions. But I remember one particular day a few years ago when I was walking to my office and I heard a student weeping in the bathroom. So this was before we were supposed to have just a general check-in research meeting. And I could tell at that meeting that the student was just trying to plow through and go on with things as if it was business as usual. But this was also the same day of the Zimmerman verdict in the unjust killing of Trayvon Martin. And so eventually we were able to peel back the layers, and I was able to talk with the student and really just have an honest conversation about that student's feelings and emotions around that verdict, the student's frustrations. And I did all this while I myself was also dealing with my own pain, my own frustrations, my own fears, and my own uncertainties around everything that had happened. So it was good for us, not easy, but good for us to be able to meet in that way and to talk through those aspects. But soon after that meeting, the same day, I had to go to another faculty meeting afterwards. When I walked into that room, it was a very surreal feeling. Everybody was jovial. People were just checking in, saying, oh, how's everybody doing? It's great to see you all. It was as if nothing had happened that had touched our national conscience at that moment. And at the time, I didn't feel the courage or the space to actually be honest about how I was feeling in that moment with everything that I was processing and everything I just processed in the meeting with that student. Frustration. Now, unfortunately, we all know that a lot of these unjust killings have continued, and there's so much that we've tried to navigate as a society to deal with these challenges. I've been very fortunate to be able to facilitate some of those conversations, particularly at the intersection of neuroscience, mental health, faith, culture, and social justice. I've been blessed to welcome many different guests to my podcast from different walks of life. This has included scientists and clinicians, faith leaders, community leaders, mental health advocates, political pundits, professional athletes, professional entertainers, and all of them have shared both from their professional expertise and their lived experience. But even in the midst of that, I've still had people come up to me and say, but you're a scientist, why are you talking about those things? Frustration. So the frustration is real, and yet I'm still motivated to continue. Why? Because I also have hope. So in the middle of the pandemic, I was also invited, as many of you probably were, to give a virtual webinar. And this webinar that I was invited to give was on the neurobiology of addiction. So in that webinar, I was talking about a lot of the work that we do in the laboratory setting, specifically in rodents, looking at behaviors that are associated with substance use disorders. Now, after I gave the talk, there was a person who emailed me and said that hearing me talk about the behavior in the rodents and what happens in the brain actually gave them more understanding and more compassion for what their son was going through and some of the behaviors their son was exhibiting in their long navigation with substance use disorder and recovery. I've also talked to psychiatry colleagues who said it's been so helpful for them to be able to lean on the research of neuroscientists to understand the brain biology of addiction and to help decrease stigma for their clients in particular who are in the middle of navigating those recovery journeys. Hope. I've also been able to host conversations on college campuses and in different cities in town hall formats, again, thinking about things at the intersection of neuroscience, mental health, faith, culture, and social justice. I've heard undergraduate students attend those events and say that those have been some of the most transformative events they've been at since they've been on campus. I've heard individuals attend those town halls in cities and say they've been waiting 20 years for these conversations. Hope. And now I'm here at APA 2023, the first time at the APA conference and surrounded by so many of you who are doing work at the forefront of these different issues and challenges and opportunities. So many who are at the forefront of how we think about, talk about, approach and address mental health and mental health challenges along with all the other topics that psychology touches. Hope. So where does that leave me at this moment? Where does that leave all of us at this moment? Well, I believe that at the crossroads between frustration and hope lies opportunity. Opportunity for us to care, opportunity for us to learn, opportunity for us to partner and to collaborate as we continue to make an impact in society. And so in these next few moments together, what I invite you to do is to join me in a journey as I describe some of the opportunities that have opened up in this realm, and as I describe the many travelers who are on this road to actually address substance use and mood disorders using neuroscience, advocacy, and social justice tools. Now, it's a journey that's also rooted in community. And so even right now, I would encourage you to think about the communities that you work with and the communities where you work, the communities also that you serve. Now, that looks different for each and every one of us. For me, that community looks a little bit like this. So on this slide, I'm just showing a few different representations of those who are involved in the work and some of the communities we serve. Now, as I mentioned, I do have a research lab that's made up of a lot of different individuals, and so we are a community in that sense, in working together within the laboratory. But especially over the last 3 years, we've been much more intentional, not only in terms of how we do the work, but how we show up in community and how we support each other. Of course, we're not only a community of a lab, we're also within a department, which is another community. We're within our School of Medicine, within our university, also part of the community of the city of New Haven, where we work, where our university is located, and obviously part of a global community as well. So I've been very fortunate and very blessed to work with individuals who are excellent in what they do when they do the research, but who are also intentional about making sure that our neuroscience is accessible to broader communities. So that influences how we talk about neuroscience, whether we're talking with another neuroscientist or whether we're talking with someone in the general public who's interested in the brain and in mental health. So when we talk about our research, we always try and start at the 30,000 foot level, so to speak, just to remind people that what we're interested in is a neurobiological basis of complex behavior. And we do that by studying animals. We look at rats in particular. And of course, whenever you hear a neuroscientist talking about rats or mice in the general public or on the media, the first question is always, are you telling me that my brain is just like that of a rat? Well, no. But obviously, there are enough similarities that we can study some of these processes in rats to understand what's happening in the brain, understand behavior, and have insights into what's happening in the human brain as well. So the other point that I always emphasize is the fact that we're looking at behaviors that are associated with mental illnesses. And so if I were speaking to the general public, what I would do next would be to ask the audience to give me some behaviors that come to mind when they think of substance use and substance misuse. And as you can imagine, people can do that very readily. So then I also ask people to think about what behaviors would they associate with anxiety or depression or other mood disorders. And again, people are able to do that very readily. Then I talk about how we model that in the lab and how we're trying to understand the processes in the brain that allow those behaviors to emerge, using that to try and understand potentially what causes those illnesses, and then to think about therapeutic interventions that can alter those processes to provide treatment. So to give you an example, one of the things that we look at in the lab, as you heard in the introduction, is addiction. And so we're looking at aspects of drug taking and drug seeking, again, in rodents. And so as is depicted here, this is a rat that's in an operant box, and the animal has access to two levers. We've also performed a surgical procedure where we have inserted a catheter into the jugular vein. So basically, the animal can self-administer drug to the jugular vein, which gives it very rapid access to the bloodstream and very rapid access to the brain. In this particular instance, every time the rat presses the active lever, they're going to receive an intravenous infusion of cocaine. They'll also hear a tone and see a light. Those will be paired with the drug and become the conditioned stimuli. There's another lever. Every time they press that, there's no programmed consequence. And what we see over time is the animals get very good at distinguishing between which lever produces cocaine and which one does not. They also get very good at titrating how much they'll take over a specific period of time. So in a two-hour session, as you can see in the black line here, they're pressing about 25 times within that two-hour period. Now, after they've gone through this behavior, we can actually take them through a period where they don't have access to the drug, and they don't have access to the cues. So it's forced abstinence and withdrawal, in a sense, detoxification. Alternatively, we can also place them back in the chamber and let them press a lever when no drug is delivered, going through extinction, akin to exposure therapy. So after these, we can then start to look at different behavioral indices of addiction-related behavior. We can look at how cues can induce craving and relapse. We can look how a stressful situation might induce relapse. We can look at how the drug itself induces relapse, and we can also look to aspects of withdrawal. Additionally, we can look at choice behavior if they have access to either the drug or something else they find rewarding. So with these tools in hand, we can then start to ask questions about substance use, about cues, about craving, and as an example, about processes in the brain like the neurotransmitter dopamine, and how that might be involved in some of these aspects. So there's a lot of work in the field that has looked at this over the years, and as you all may know, rewarding substances, like substances and other things, increase dopamine concentrations in the brain. This can be nicotine, for instance, from a combustible cigarette or an e-cigarette, and we do see those increases in reward centers of the brain, specifically in an area called the ventral striatum or nucleus accumbens. But we also know the cues that are associated with substances also lead to increases in dopamine in these same reward areas. And these increases in dopamine are known to impact goal-directed behavior. They're known to facilitate craving, and they can also facilitate drug-seeking behavior. So what do we do with this information? Well, a few years ago, I was at a conference and met someone who had expertise in L-type calcium channels. These are channels that exist in the brain, but they also exist in the heart, and they let calcium into the cell. Both in the brain and in the heart, they're actually important for electrical conductivity. And so there were a few things about these channels that caught our attention. One, they exist in brain reward pathways, and they've been shown to alter dopamine activity. The same dopamine activity that I talked about is important for craving, relapse, and goal-directed behavior. There have also been genetic studies that have looked at these L-type calcium channels and have found that alterations in these genes are associated with neuropsychiatric illnesses, specifically bipolar disorder and some substance use disorders. Now, I also mentioned that these channels also exist in the heart, and it turns out that there are FDA-approved inhibitors of these channels that are antihypertensive medications. So now we have a situation where we could potentially repurpose these FDA-approved antihypertensives for things like substance use disorder. So with that information and the tools that we have in hand, we start to look at some of these behaviors. And what we have found is that if we look at relapse behavior, this is a specific example from cue-induced drug-seeking behavior, if we block those L-type calcium channels with antihypertensives in specific areas of the reward areas of the brain, or give the agent systemically, we do see a decrease in the relapse behavior, and that's acting through dopamine. We can also look at anxiety-related behavior. So this is an apparatus that's known as the elevated plus maze. As the name implies, it's elevated off the ground about 40 centimeters. If you give a rat an agent that induces anxiety in people, they'll spend more time in those closed arms hiding from the elements, as it were. If you give them an agent that's anxiolytic and decreases anxiety, they'll spend more time in the open arms. What we found is that while animals are in cocaine withdrawal, they actually decrease how much time they spend in the open arms, so they have an anxiety, pro-anxiety response, and we can reverse that if we give an antihypertensive medication. Similarly, we can look at things like hedonia and anhedonia. And rats like us, many of us, I should say, prefer things that are sweet. So if you give them an option between sucrose and water, they'll have a high preference for sucrose. Again, if they go through cocaine withdrawal, they decrease that preference, and you can reverse that if you block those L-type calcium channels. It turns out that a lot of these behaviors that we're looking at can also be induced by chronic unpredictable stressors. And in both rodents and humans, exposure to these chronic unpredictable stressors can lead to depressive-like phenotypes. And similarly, if we block those L-type calcium channels with the antihypertensives, we can reverse those symptoms and those phenotypes as well. We're also able to look at things like motivation. So there's an experiment and a procedure known as the effort-related choice paradigm, where animals have access to either freely available chow, or they have to work really hard for a highly palatable sucrose pellet, which they prefer. There's a human correlate of this test as well, where people can actually work for freely or more easily available low monetary rewards, or have to work harder for higher monetary rewards. Now, it turns out in both rats and humans, if you increase dopamine levels in the brain, both the rats and humans will work harder for the high effort reward. If you deplete dopamine, both rats and humans will go for the low effort reward. So now we have a situation where we can take something from the rats, translate to humans, and potentially back translate back to rats to look at similar mechanisms in both. So as neuroscientists, when this happens, we start to get very excited. We start drawing diagrams with different brain regions and trying to figure out how the L-type calcium channels can influence all these processes. I'm seeing a lot of smiles, so you may have had these conversations or have done this yourself. That's all well and good, but what we're particularly excited about is experiments that we're actually now setting up with our clinical colleagues to look at these processes in clinical populations, looking again at substance use disorder, also mood disorders, and comorbid substance use and mood disorders. But still, what do we do with all this information? Now, unfortunately, as I speak for myself and my colleagues as neuroscientists, sometimes we take all that information and we get a little bit confused. We go to a situation that looks like this. Now, if that mouth is representing all the information that we have, it's like we've taken a megaphone and turned it towards ourselves. Now, this illustration was inspired by a conversation that I had with a hip-hop artist on my podcast when he said, it seems like academia has gotten things backward. You have all this information, you've taken the megaphone, pointed it at yourselves, and you can't get the information out to the general public. Even worse, when we do get the information out to the general public, sometimes it looks something like this. So the megaphone is still pointed the wrong way. We have all this information, and it comes out like a bunch of nonsense that's non-decipherable. And I'm seeing a lot of nods and confirmations that you all have experienced this in different shapes and forms. So what do we do? How do we move forward? Well, again, I've been fortunate to at least try and facilitate that through some conversations on the Addy Hour podcast. And I'm just giving you a sample here of the 40-plus episodes that we've done at this point, but we've been very intentional about having these intersections between neuroscience, mental health, faith, culture, and social justice. For our first episode, we talked about all the things that you're not supposed to talk about around the dinner table: wellness, pandemics, race, and politics. And for that conversation, I invited a clinical psychologist, Dr. Jeff Gardier, and paired him with a political scientist, Andrew Gillespie. We've talked about the science of trauma and resilience with physician scientist Carrie Ressler and eminent neuroscientist Bianca Jones Marlin. We've talked about black bodies and race in art and society with visual artist Imal Imeh and philosopher Daniel Swan. We also had an episode on psychology, society, and faith with your own Dr. Tama Bryant. We've also considered mental health, the military, and the unseen wounds of war with two veterans, Stephen Elliott and Tony Williams, and PTSD expert Barbara Rothbaum. We've considered mental health politics and advocacy with former U.S. Representative Patrick Kennedy. We've thought about mental health, race, culture, and wellness in Asian American and Pacific Islander communities with Jeremy Lin and Esther Chu. And we've also talked about faith, community, and mental health partnerships with Dr. Ayanna Jordan and Dr. Sydney Hankerson, particularly focusing on their transformative work where they are delivering addiction services and depression services in church settings through partnerships, particularly with Black and Latinx churches. So again, we return to opportunity. Opportunity that we have to think creatively outside of our disciplines, outside of our perspectives, across our lived experience, and across our expertise. And we can do that to create new opportunities to move things forward. By doing so, we can create spaces where neuroscientists can be sitting in the same room with clinical psychologists and thinking about how medications and behavioral therapy impact the brain and impact behavioral health, and where they can learn from each other. We can create opportunities where a hip-hop artist and best-selling author gets invited to give grand rounds at a psychiatry department at an institution, talking to academics. And in that venue, shares his music that's related to mental health, but also talks about social determinants of health, talks about the transgenerational effects of slavery, talks about access, talks about stigma, and talks about mental health breakthroughs. We can create opportunities where youth of color are starting groups within their schools to talk about mental health and initiating those conversations with their parents. We can create opportunities where people will gather at a public library to talk about addiction, to hear about the neuroscience of addiction, but also to share their own stories with their recovery journeys. And so in all of this, I land again at a place of hope, a place of hope where I feel like we are actually taking advantage of these opportunities and we can continue to do more to learn from one another, to care for those around us, and continue to make an impact as we partner and collaborate. So in a sense, I'm also grateful to all of you and thanking all of you for the work that you're doing in this way and for the ways that we'll all be able to continue to collaborate together. Thank you very much.